Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Zombie Wars, The Enemy Within, by Joseph Talluto. Narrated by Graham Halstead. Iowa. How many? We don't have to talk about this now. I hate repeating myself. 43. Mother of God. Not your fault, sir? Yes, it is. I sent them in, and they died. Had to be done, sir. I know, and I'd do it again. God help me. I stayed out of the conversation, since this was Charlie's command. We had been on the road for just a few weeks now, making our way across the state of Illinois and into Iowa. At Sarah's insistence, we had waited until the first hard frost had arrived, and then we had set out. We had been on the road for 7 months prior, and had managed to clear out a huge swath of the United States of the majority of zombies. We couldn't get them all, but we had managed to get enough of them that they weren't a constant danger. The cities we had left alone, hundreds of thousands of zombies, possibly millions, was just something we weren't able to deal with. So we used the highways that ringed most major metropolitan areas and turned them into barricades. Chicago was the exception. That one we used cargo containers to keep it locked up, and if I had to do it all over again, I'd have opted for the highway method. We took the biggest earth movers we could find and basically tore up the asphalt, piling it on the city side. Bulldozers followed, creating trenches that would contain an outbreak if the zombies found a way over. It was crude, but effective. I snapped out of my musings when Charlie repeated my name. John? I'm sorry, I drifted away there for a moment. What was the question? I asked, looking from Charlie to the soldier who was waiting by the door. Will you say something at the burial? Charlie asked. Of course. Be glad to. Sorry, I said. Charlie dismissed the soldier with a quick salute. Then he turned to me. Where's your head? He asked. Don't tell me it's with Sarah and your boys. I pointed to the map on the wall of the trailer we were using as a command center. It's a lot of country to cover, brother, I said. Starting to have some doubts about this. Charlie nodded. I hear you, but we're in this to finish it. I don't want my daughter or your sons having to worry about getting attacked when they take a stroll down the road, or anyone else's kids for that matter. There is that. I was thinking about splitting the army again, I said, pointing to the northern states. These states weren't heavily populated even when there weren't any zombies around. If we send maybe 3,000 to sweep north, I said, moving my hand across Minnesota, North Dakota, and Montana, we can clear 3 states and see if our neighbors to the north had managed to weather the storm as well. Charlie nodded. Makes sense. With the numbers we have now, we can split again like we did before and cover more ground. No going off on our own again, though, I said. Hell no. That was enough for me. Charlie shook his head. Rebecca was a wreck. Was not happy about all the things I told her. Why do you tell everything anyway? I asked. She just gets more worried every time you step out the door. Don't ever want to go to my maker knowing I lied to my wife before I had a chance to apologize, Charlie said simply. Fair enough. Now let's go over this mess we got ourselves into right now. 43 dead? That was a hell of a fight, I said. Charlie pointed to the map of the town in front of him. We did everything we did before. Run through with a vehicle, walk through opening doors, draw them out, and kill them. Pretty straightforward. Worked 12 times before. But this time they stayed hidden until we came in strength, and they hit us from the rear. 10 people were down in the first wave of the attack. 4 people died from friendly fire, and the rest just got isolated and overwhelmed, Charlie said, shaking his head. I should have seen it. They've been getting smarter, and I didn't see it. It was my turn to shake my head. How could you possibly have known? If anything, I should have set up a research lab at the Capitol to study the Z's and see how they were progressing in their evolution. No one could have known, I said. But if there is any benefit to this, we know now, and what we'll do is set up a second line that walks through behind the first, and if the zombies come out to play, they'll find themselves between 2 really pissed off groups of survivors. Charlie nodded. Good, good. We'll tell the fighters that. They'll like the trap. Settles that problem, then. When is the burial? I asked, looking out the window. I don't know. Figured we'd get down to it tomorrow and be done with it. No point in waiting. The ground is getting harder to dig through, Charlie said. All right. Come get me beforehand. I'll do the service, I said. You okay? You seem someplace else, Charlie asked with a slight tilt of his head. I nodded. Just thinking about the whole situation. I'm all right, I said, clapping Charlie on the shoulder. I left the small command office and walked through the camp. We were in Iowa, and contrary to what most people thought, Iowa wasn't just flatlands and farmland. On the eastern end, anyway, there were rolling hills, deep streams, and about 1,000 places for zombies to hide. We kept the camp mobile, using vans and RVs and trucks to transport everyone. When we traveled, we tended to split into 4 or 5 groups, pick a destination, and clear all of the zombies out of the area we could find before the rendezvous. We took what was useful from unoccupied homes and left alone anyone who was still alive. Most of the time, we gave them supplies as they needed them. We cleared out every small town and home of any zombies, leaving them ready for anyone to come and reclaim. Sarah and Rebecca had put a lot of thought into this. We agreed that it would be best not to try and get everyone to come back to the capital, but to leave them where they were comfortable and 99% zombie-free. As the chief executive, I was given a huge RV for the war, but I downsized it to something a little easier to maneuver through the back roads of America. I gave the RV to a platoon of women to use as their home, while I hooked up a travel trailer to a Ford F-150 King cab. I preferred the idea of being able to bug out with a truck and not have to try and manage a bus. As far as the platoon was concerned, any group of zombies dumb enough to tackle them was going to have a very short time to regret it before their undead life became their very dead life. The chill air was welcome for a very short time, and then I was hunching my shoulders against it. I pulled my hood up and watched as the November winds played out across the prairie. Old crops swayed with the breezes, and here and there was a rustle of movement as a rodent of some sort made a sortie out for food. I walked to the top of a small hill, and it gave me a slight vantage point for looking over the camp. We were several miles out of Cedar Rapids, and I had sent scouts ahead to see if there was any easy way to deal with the threat. The cold weather worked to our advantage, slowing down the zombies, but they were evolving ever so slightly. They knew enough to try and stay out of the cold if they could help it. Bad news for them, they could never stay inside when food was nearby. Bad news for us, they could never stay inside when we were nearby. But they were sluggish enough that our best defense was a quick walk out of danger. I planned to use the cold to our advantage and clean up as many as we could without taking too many casualties. Charlie's raid blew that apart, but I wasn't going to fault him for it. Who knew an entire middle school had turned and the preteens were going to attack from the rear? As it was, had it been summer and they were as fast as they could have been, they'd have wiped out that entire command. The RVs, trucks, and trailers lined the road. We stayed in contact through CB radios and handheld radios. Everyone was required to turn on their radio at 8 o'clock at night for the next day's instructions. I could see the flickering lights of lamps and candles as I walked past, and I returned the salute of several fighters as they returned from patrol. When I started this fight, I figured to lead the Grand Army to victory. But I learned I was better at small unit tactics and wound up off on my own. I then realized I didn't like letting other people go off and fight for me when I wasn't with them. I decided to put the army back together, but lead it like it was a small unit. So far, it worked like a charm. Then we got ambushed. Have to settle that tomorrow. Sir! I turned at the voice and found myself looking at a young man, likely no older than 18. He was dressed warmly, with his weapons strapped on the outside of his coat. His forearms were covered in sheet metal ductwork, a trick the deep scouts used to gain a second if they found themselves in a bad situation. His dark eyes were serious. He had seen more in his young life than many people before him had seen in several lifetimes. I recognized him after a minute. Hassad, right? I asked, shifting out of the wind. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I went to Commander James, and he said to find you. The scout of Cedar Rapids is finished, Hassad said. And? I asked. Original population was around 100,000, sir. We counted at least half that, probably more. I thought about it. Good enough. We'll go over the rest of the report in the morning. And Hassad? Sir, shoot that zombie up there, would you? I asked, pointing to the slow-moving figure that had appeared about 500 yards away. It moved with the unmistakable shamble of a ghoul and was headed right for camp. Hassad slipped his rifle off his shoulder and aimed for a second. I could see him adjusting his aim for the wind, and then he let the shot go. I watched for a second, and then the zombie shifted to the side, falling down. Hassad shouldered his rifle and smiled at me. Anything else, sir? He asked. I smiled back. Several heads poked out of doors, watching us and looking out their windows to see if they could see what he was shooting at. He's getting up, Hassad. Shit, not for long. The young man took off across the land, making a straight line for the zombie. When he reached a closer hill, he stopped, aimed for a longer moment, and then made a killing shot. Truth be known, I would have been stunned had he made a killing shot at 500 yards. Just hitting a zombie at that distance was hard. He had done it in a good wind. I smiled when I figured he'd be harder on himself than I could ever be with him. It was times like this that I thought about my friend Nate, how much we could use his experience and knowledge in this fight. I reached my trailer and stopped for a moment. Around us, the long grasses swayed in the evening breeze. It was cold, but not bad, especially for the Midwest. I had lived here for years, so I knew what the storms could be like, but I also knew that we had long stretches of cold without snow that would serve us very well right now. Keep the zombies slow, but make sure we could see them. Snow-covered Zs were not fun when spring came and thawed them out. A young hawk soared overhead, likely looking for a place to spend the night. We had a lot of them following us. Our passage usually spooked the game in the area, making hunting easier. If we were a flotilla, I guess they'd be sharks. Daddy! Jake's voice was the first thing I heard when I entered the trailer. He was playing at the table while Sarah was feeding Aaron. Aaron was a big boy, likely to become a big man. Sarah looked up briefly, then went back to feeding. Jake came off the seat with a bounce and jumped into my arms.
When we leave, Daddy?
Jake asked, pulling at my coat.
Will we leave soon? Soon?
I tussled his hair and looked into his deep brown eyes. When we finish here, buddy, we got a lot of work to do tomorrow.
Can I see a cow? Are there cows around here? When can I see a cow?
Jake barely stopped for a breath, his eyes already looking out the windows for a cow we couldn't see if it was in front of us. Soon, pal, soon. Can Daddy take off his gear and settle in before you ask too many questions? I said, putting him back onto the floor.
Can I have a snack?
Jake asked, turning his big brown eyes on me.
Ahem.
Sarah looked up again and gave Jake one of her looks. Jake hunched his shoulders and looked up at me with sad eyes. I squatted down to be eye level with my son. Did you ask Mommy already? I asked.
Yes,
Jake said quietly. Did she say no?
Yes.
There's your answer, little man. I looked at Jake sternly. Don't do that again, I said, knowing he would the next chance he got. Jake looked down.
Okay.
Take my coat to the closet, Jake. When you're done, look in the pocket. We might find something for you, I said. Jake grabbed my coat and ran to the closet, dragging it across the floor. He fairly threw it in the small space and then rummaged the pockets. When he found the small car I had in there, he squeaked and ran back to his room, where he pulled out a small box full of little cars. My coat never made it further than the floor. Oh, well. I kissed Sarah and placed a gentle hand on Aaron's head. His eyes never opened as he continued with his bottle, his little mouth working to get as much in his belly as possible.
Hey, you,
Sarah said.
How did your meeting with Charlie go?
I stretched and rolled my head back. Badly.
Oh, dear. How many?
43, I said quietly.
Oh, my God. What happened?
Sarah shifted, and Aaron answered with a small burp. Then he kept going. ambushed from behind by a crowd of middle schoolers. Nothing anyone could have done, I said. We'll be into Cedar Rapids tomorrow. Sarah nodded. Then she turned her very green eyes on me.
John, is this worth it? I mean, I know you're in this to make sure Jake and Aaron and all the other kids can grow up without looking over their shoulder all the time. But my God, if we take more losses like that, we won't have an army. I don't mean from death by zombie.
I thought about it. It has to be, Sarah. We have to be the ones to do it. There's no one else. No one I know about anyway. Besides, what happened today shouldn't happen again. We have a plan, and we'll get it done.
How long will we be on the road? Sarah asked.
I don't know, I said honestly. If I had another 20,000 fighters, I would guess a year. But with what we have now, maybe two, possibly three. I looked carefully at Sarah. Are you wanting to head home? If you are, just say so, and I'll get a driver and an escort tomorrow to get you and the boys back to Starved Rock.
I didn't say that, Sarah said quickly. My place is with you, but I worry about bringing Jake and Aaron into the war.
Me too. But they're as safe here as anywhere. I'd rather you were with me than at home. There's no one I'd rather have my back than you, I said. Sarah smiled. She shifted Aaron and held him to her shoulder. A few small pats and a very satisfied burp came from him. I was always amazed that such a large sound could come from such a small person. She rocked him gently. I could see his eyes close and his body relax against his mother.
I'll put this guy to bed if you want to put the other one to bed as well, Sarah said, moving to the front of the trailer to put Aaron in his crib.
On my way. I got up and walked back to the rear of the trailer where Jake had his bed. There was room for a queen-size bed back there, but since we didn't need all that room, we put in a couple of storage units, and Jake slept on a bunk on the far wall. His bed was attached to the top of two dressers, one that held his clothes and the other his toys. He was in the middle of the room playing with his cars when I came in. Bedtime, Shorty, I said, gathering up some of his toys.
I'm not tired, Jake said automatically.
Don't have to be. You just have to go to bed, I said, just as automatically. Jake grumbled as he climbed the little ladder to his bed. He tumbled into the bedding, covering himself with his blankets. He curled into a ball and turned away from me, another way he expressed his displeasure with going to bed early. I leaned over and kissed his head anyway, for no other reason than to irritate him a little further. He hunched even deeper under the covers, and I left his room with a smile. I put the rest of my gear away and made my way to the master bedroom. It was a big room, even for a trailer, but it wasn't the biggest I could have chosen. There were trailers in our midst that had two floors for sleeping quarters. They were that big. I had no use for anything of that size, and by the time the boys were big enough to argue over separate rooms, I hoped to be living back at the lodge where they could have dozens of rooms to choose from. I took off most of my clothing and settled into the bed next to Sarah. I put my arms around her, and she slipped back into me, molding her body next to mine. We lay like that for a long time, and I listened to her breathing become slow and more regular. I was drifting off to sleep myself when I heard something quiet but insistent.
Daddy? Daddy?
I sighed. Jake could be a big pain in the ass when it came to going to sleep. Sometimes he played these games. I was tempted to ignore him and let him figure it out when he did it again.
Daddy?
It was a little louder, and he squeaked a little. That was different. I was fully awake now, and I could sense Sarah was as well.
What's wrong?
Sarah could likely feel the tension in me as I listened to the darkness. I don't know. Watch Aaron. I slipped out of bed and quickly put my jeans on. I had no trouble facing danger without a shirt, but it was weird without pants of some sort. I tucked my Glock into the back pocket, grip inward for a quicker draw. Some people liked reverse appendix carry, but I never was comfortable sweeping myself with my own gun. I moved quietly down the trailer and into Jake's room. Jake was huddled into a ball under his covers, and I could tell he was nervous because he jumped when I touched him.
Daddy?
The little mound whispered again. I'm here, Jake. Daddy's here. Daddy's got you.
What's wrong? I looked around and didn't see anything that could have spooked him.
I saw a man outside, Jake said,
pointing a little hand towards the windows at the rear of the trailer. From Jake's vantage point, he could see out the windows that he normally couldn't when he was on the floor.
Probably just a guard, Jake. They're supposed to be there. They keep us safe. No, I seen his eyes.
His eyes, Jake? How could you see his eyes in the dark? I asked.
Shining eyes, Jake said.
Ah, hell. We had a zombie in the perimeter. I scooped up Jake and brought him to the front of the trailer. Sarah was waiting for us, and Jake slipped into her arms. I answered the question in her eyes. Outside. I'll be a minute. May have an unwanted guest, I said.
Please be careful, Sarah said.
She ran a hand over Jake's hair, while her other hand checked the proximity of her gun. She liked the Glock 19 for field work since we could swap mags and ammo, but for home defense she had her baby, which was a stainless SIG X5. The gun fit her hand like a glove and had a sweet trigger. Sarah could hit a 2-inch target all day long at 40 yards with that gun. I put my coat back on and put my Glock in the cabinet. I couldn't risk firing a gun with all the trailers that were around me, so I'd have to do this the old-fashioned way. I took out my pick and my buoy, hoping I'd not need either, but I had a feeling it was going to come to that. I put on a long-sleeved shirt and my vest, giving myself some protection against the cold. Boots and gloves came next, and then I was out the door. I stepped away from the vehicle and circled wide to the rear, trying to figure out which way the zombie might have gone that Jake saw. I didn't doubt he saw something, and he had seen enough of the real thing to know it when he saw it. I was grateful he had enough sense not to start screaming and draw the thing right to us. As much as I hated hunting Z's in the dark, this was preferable to having one of the stupid things bang on your trailer trying to get in. The sky was overcast, and it was dark as hell. Out in the wild, without any ground lights, it got very black. Things were quiet in the camp, which explained why the zombie was just wandering through. As far as he was concerned, I was sure this was just a weird forest of metal that happened to be in his way. I moved quietly around the trailer and looked at the area where Jake had seen his monster. I didn't bother checking for any tracks since hundreds of feet had passed this way. I thought about making some kind of noise, but I figured that would make me the subject of the hunt, not the zombie. I thought about where it might have gone when I heard someone laughing about 100 feet from where I was. Bingo. If I heard it, the ghoul heard it, and he would go in that direction. I moved quietly, keeping away from the trucks, trailers, and campers that covered the landscape. I didn't want to be surprised by a ghoul that suddenly came out from underneath a trailer or something. I walked quietly, checking behind me and searching for glowing eyes. That was the only thing that made hunting zombies at night palatable. Fun part was, not all of their eyes glowed. Most of them, but not all. Truth was, it was creepy as hell. I listened carefully and thought I heard a sound further down the lane. It sounded like a soft scrape on asphalt and was not repeated like someone was trying to be quiet. I hope to God they weren't evolving enough to try sneaking up on people. That would be just plain unfair. I moved quietly, and ducking around a trailer, I got a glimpse of a dark shape moving silently through the encampment. It moved slowly, glancing from side to side. I heard the laughter again, but this time it was behind me. The zombie in front of me should have turned around, but he didn't. That wasn't normal. As I watched, the shape moved quietly towards a trailer and looked inside a window before moving on. That wasn't right either. All evidence I was seeing was telling me this wasn't a zombie, but a live person. I was about to challenge whoever they were when they suddenly turned around to check their back. I was between two trailers, so I just stepped back out of sight, but I managed to see the man's eyes, and that explained what Jake had seen. The man was wearing some sort of goggles, and they glowed pale green in the night. Not something any of our men used. We tried night vision goggles before, but they were limited in what they could be used for, and the men preferred flashlights anyway. I moved around the other side of the trailer and up front as quickly as I could, trying to get in front of the man. I wanted to stop him without killing him, since he was clearly not from our camp. When I reached the point I wanted, I turned into the lane and looked for the man to approach. A quick glance showed me nothing. Shit, he moved. He didn't come out my side, so he had to have gone out the other side. I moved across the lane and through the line of RVs on the other side. As I crossed to the other side, I ducked suddenly and rolled forward as a stabbing blade skimmed over my back. I jumped forward and spun around, facing the man with the glowing green eyes. He was holding a long bladed knife and held it like he knew what to do with it. I shifted my buoy to my left hand while I lengthened the hold on my pick. That gave me another 10 inches of reach, and the move wasn't lost on the intruder. He stepped back and then jumped forward, his left hand reaching for my pick while his knife stabbed towards my throat. I wasn't going to give up that easily. I flipped my pick under his grasping hand and held it straight out, holding tight as he ran into the metal end with his mouth. His knife never got closer than 8 inches as he fell back, holding his teeth. I swung low for his knee, and as he stepped back out of the way, I stopped the pick and jabbed it upwards again, connecting with the goggles on his face. His head jerked back, and he ripped the eyepieces off, blinking as his eyes adjusted to the darkness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.